Hallelujah.
Amen. It's awesome to be back in the house of God. I want to welcome everyone to Harvest Midweek Bible Study / Worship Service. I don't want to leave out Worship Service. We've been having a great time studying Sermon on the Mount. I understand they had an awesome time in the Next Level Leadership class on last night. And we had a great time on Sunday. So, God is doing great and awesome things here at Harvest. I'm glad so many came out. I know it's raining, but we're glad you pressed on. Do we have any guests tonight? Any guests? You got guests? Well, you not normally come on Wednesday night, do you?
Yeah.
You do?
Oh, well.
Hey, Doug,
okay.
Doug, he's wearing off on
me. Okay. Well, maybe when we worship today, maybe if you dance up around the front during worship, I'll make sure I recognize you. Amen. I just thank God for another service. I've been really enjoying this teaching. How many have been enjoying the teaching here? Amen. Amen. Pastor was right on time talking about praise and worship on last Sunday, and I was thinking, he mentioned something about David, how David was dancing before the Lord when they brought the Ark of the Covenant in Jerusalem. And, you know, a lot of people, men especially, don't think it's macho or manly to praise and worship God. I'll let you know, David was a man's man. Man, he killed a lion and a bear, killed Goliath when all the rest of the soldiers were scared. And then he was the king of Israel. And they say he danced before the Lord, he jumped and kicked till he was half naked. Amen. And just because he was bringing the Ark of the Covenant back in Jerusalem. And they say Saul's daughter saw him out of the window. And they said she despised him in his heart. She looked at him and was embarrassed at him. And she approached David about it and asked David that, you out here dancing naked in front of these slaves, in front of these slaves and your servant. And David's response for it was that it was God that chose me over my father and all of my brothers. It was God that anointed me king of Israel. He said, you thought I praised him then, you ain't seen nothing yet. He said, I'll praise him to the point I'm ashamed of my own self. Amen. And that's kind of how I feel. He said, I'll praise him till I'm ashamed of my own self. But what a lot of people didn't see in that scripture, Saul's daughter that despised him, I don't know if that was his wife at the time, but the Bible said, because she did that, despised him, she had no child until her death. So, as people praise and worship God, you need to be careful how you feel and how you feel about their praise and their worship. Because they're doing it because what God has did for them. And David said, because he chose me. He chose me over my father. When my father didn't think I was good enough. And they brought all the brothers in before, but he chose me and anointed me as king. And that was his praise all about. Amen. So everybody has a praise. And I want to encourage you. Give God your best in praise and worship. And as you praise him and you honor him, God will reveal his holiness to you. Yes. And when he show you himself and how holy he is and how righteous he is, you can't do nothing but worship him. Amen. Let's make ready to receive our tithe and offering. I'm loving this teaching, and so I don't want to prolong the time. This tithe and offering scripture is from 2 Samuel 24:24. It says, then the king said to Aurora, no, but I will surely buy it from you for a price. Nor will I offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God with that which costs me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. David refused to offer anything to the Lord without it costing him something. Amen. Let us pray. Father, I just thank you. Lord, I thank you for what you're doing here in the midst of your people. I thank you for what you're doing in our heart and our spirit, man. I thank you for revealing yourself to us and revealing your holiness and your righteousness. Lord, as we worship you tonight in our tithe and our offering and worship you in song, Lord, as we praise you, Lord, we ask you to reveal yourself to us. Show us how holy and righteous you are. Show us our wretchedness in your sight. Reveal to us your worth. For you're worthy of praise. And besides you, there's none other to worship. Be the object of our worship tonight. And Lord, we just thank you for who you are. We thank you for being able to give tonight. And Lord, we actually bless what we give, bless what we're doing here at Harvest, that we may truly be your hands and feet here on earth. And we give you all the praise and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Receive the night's tithe and offering. And after you give it, we want you to stand and worship the Lord with us.
You can turn around and tell two or three people hi, hello. It's good to see you. Who's reading his name? Bye.
Go out and work with Reimagine and Miss Sarah and her team that goes up on the Reimagine trips. This one's in Century, so on Saturday they're going to go out and serve, because part of the discipleship process is serving. So they're going to go out and serve Reimagine, not just our table where the diapers are, but also throughout the entire Reimagine place for about 4 hours on Saturday. So, and it's going to end on Sunday, and I'm hoping that all of them that participate in the discipleship now will be in service on Sunday morning as well. And then this Sunday we'll also be recognizing our graduates. We have several graduating from high school and one graduating from college that we will be recognizing, and we are compiling that information for the last couple of weeks, and we have all of that in, so we're looking forward to that. Be sure that you pick up a bulletin insert that has all the information of all the different things. I know next Tuesday, really quickly, will be food pickup days, so we'll be picking up food. I believe it's on Tuesday, if I'm right. We'll be picking up food and unloading the trailer and getting ready for our next opportunity to distribute. So we thank the Lord for those opportunities. But make sure you make yourself aware of all of that. Thank you for braving what is commonly known as Christian kryptonite. Rain. Rain has the uncanny ability to make people too weak to get up and make it to church, but you have the antidote. And so, and there's a line in the street. So we're glad that you're here. And we needed the rain. I know that. My yard needed it. I don't know if yours needed it, but mine. My place needed it in its time of refreshing, but we're glad that you're here. I like to have fun with that. I can't remember where I heard or came up with that Christian kryptonite thing, but it does seem to work on some, doesn't it? Hallelujah. We're in Matthew chapter number 6. We're in the Sermon on the Mount. I'm telling you, last night in our Next Level Leadership class, we had some of the best discussion on some of the most difficult topics that you can do in an hour and a half. And between Wednesday, now I love Sunday, don't get me wrong, I love to preach. I do love to preach. But between teaching on Wednesday night and teaching once a month in that discipleship now, I mean that Next Level Leadership class, I am just enjoying digging into the Word of God. So I'm glad that you come out, because you make Wednesday nights awesome by coming out and participating. We're going to pick up in verse number 24. How many can tell me where what topic we left off with last month? Say again. light. We're talking about the eye. And so we're going to pick up in verse number 24. We were talking about how the eye is the lamp for the body, and what passes through our eye determines the level of light that is inside of us, and whatever is inside of us determines what comes out of us. So we need to make sure that we are loading ourselves up and using this lamp for the body as a place to receive light and receive more light. So then we're going to move into verse number 24. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24 says, "No one can serve two masters." Now, before I read any further, I want to remind us, when we began, you know, I talked about how the Sermon on the Mount is Jesus' first message, most famous message, most powerful sermon in context, but also talked about how he was telling us things. This is the way I thought about it today as I was just reviewing my notes for tonight. I thought that if this wasn't preparation for Jesus sending us the Holy Spirit, telling us how we need to live, this would be the equivalent to Jesus coming and giving the law over again as Moses did. Because when Moses gave the law, no one was able to keep that law. No one was able to do that. That's why they had to initiate the sacrificial laws to go along with it. But when Jesus came, and we're going to see it tonight if we get that far, when he was preaching this message, and remember this was disciples, whether you want to take the line that it was just his disciples or whether you want to take the line that it was a bunch of disciples and just his disciples were sitting close to him, he was preaching to his followers. He was talking to his followers. And so as we've been studying this, we need to keep in mind that he is telling us how we need to live and preparing us for how he's going to help us live this way. Remember when we were talking about the Ten Commandments, how Jesus raised the bar, so to speak, on all of those and made it more about a heart issue than about an activity issue. And so I wanted to remind us of that before we get into tonight. I've been meaning to do that every week, but every few weeks I'll remind us that the Holy Spirit and the coming of the Holy Spirit has a lot to do with what Jesus is talking about here. So he talks about no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Let's stop in verse number 24. You cannot serve God and mammon. What do we understand mammon to be? Money. In a very general term, mammon is understood to be money, the things of this life, but primarily money, primarily the pursuit of money. And so what Jesus is saying here is what? You can't serve two masters. Why can you not do that? That's also in Scripture too, but not in this part of Scripture. But why can we not serve two masters? He talks about later in Scripture, a house divided cannot stand. So you cannot have two allegiances.
I think the means of making money and extra jobs to become an idol in your life.
They certainly can. Absolutely.
Depend on that, Lord, and depend on God.
And that it becomes an object of worship. And we would never say that with our mouth, but we can certainly say it with our actions. Most of us would not say. Now, there are a few people in the world that probably would have no problem saying that they worship money and the things that they can get with it. But most of us would never do that. But remember, Jesus, there must have been an issue with this. And by the way, Jesus spoke more about money on more occasions than he did about grace. So he had a lot to say about money and how to handle money and what to do with money and how dangerous money is, how beneficial it can be, what we need it for and what we don't need it for. But here he's just simply saying, you can't serve two masters. You're going to have to choose which master you're going to serve. Are you going to serve God? And if you are, he's about to tell us some other things that are going to change in our life if we choose to serve him. If you choose to serve mammon, well, we know where that's going to lead to. A separation of a relationship with God. And it kind of refers back to the passage of Scripture we talked about last week about the eye, about having single vision. Because what is double vision is division, right? It's where your vision is divided And Jesus is saying, you can't have divided vision, you can't have divided sight, you can't have divided loyalties. You are either going to, and he uses the stronger words, you're going to love one and hate the other. Because they can't exist together. They don't have that capability of existing together. So we see that money is going to be the temporal possession, status with man. And God, if we serve God, it's going to be the eternal and gaining status with God. So that's what Jesus is talking about here. And then he moves in to a longer dissertation that we're going to break down into segments tonight. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, it says, because you can't serve one or the other, here's what I'm going to say to you. If you choose to serve me, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Then look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? Let's stop in verse 27. So he's talking about here, he's talking about our sustenance. He's talking about what we're going to eat, how we're going to stay alive. And he is saying to us here that if you're going to pursue me, if you're going to pursue God, if you're going to serve God, you need to not worry about your needs. What does he say in Scripture about our needs? My God shall, y'all are getting quiet on me tonight. Don't do that. My God shall supply all of your according to his riches and glory through Christ Jesus. So Jesus here is saying, I'm going, if you'll trust me, if you'll walk with me, if you'll devote yourself to me, I'm going to take care of every need that you have. I'm going to feed you. And then he uses the illustration of the birds of the field, how they don't work and store up, but that he makes sure they're fed, because they come by our house and go to our bird feeders, or they go to Barbara's house and hit Barbara's bird feeders. God uses us to make sure the birds of the air are fed, but they had nothing to do with that. He makes sure that they have something to eat. And if we didn't have bird feeders, they'd still be eating, right? He's going to take care of them. And he says, are we not more valuable to him than the birds of the air? So this whole section here is going to be about worry. He's going to use our basic life needs, like food and clothing coming up in a minute, to teach us about worrying. Because have you ever ate a sandwich just by worrying? Has worry ever brought Rockies or Domino's to your door? Now, I've worried about them being on time. But worry has never brought food into my house. And he's saying, you've got to get to a place where you're following me so closely that you're going to trust me for every need that you have. Now, as we get into this, we're going to get into some real uncomfortable places about needs and wants and all that kind of stuff. Okay? We're going to revisit there because Jesus teaches about it. So let's look at the next passage of Scripture. So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothes the lilies and the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? What is he saying in that passage of Scripture about worry? Worry is the opposite of faith. Worry, can we be stronger than that? What is worry in our relationship with God? Lack of faith, but there's a lack of another word too. Lack of trust. See, we need to have faith and trust in God. We can have all the faith in the world that God is who he says he is, but to trust him, to have the faith to trust him, to meet our needs, to take care of us as we pursue him, as we pursue a relationship with him. Now listen, Jesus is not telling people not to work, because throughout Scripture it's saying, if you don't work, You don't eat. So this is not what Jesus is saying.
A lot of people think you have to put a lot of hours into work to get promotion.
Yeah.
But the Bible says promotion don't come from the east or the west. It comes from above.
That's right.
And so a lot of people, they devote all their time to work and neglect the one that gives them promotion. And wonder why they don't get promotion. And so you spend more time with God, that's where promotion comes.
So our eyes then become on the prize instead of on the one who supplies the prize. And so we work diligently for the prize because there's nothing wrong with the prize. Jesus is not saying these things are inherently evil, that food and clothing are evil. He knows we got to have them. But what he's saying, if you will focus on me, I'm going to meet all of those needs. And that's a great illustration that sometimes we put our trust in the system more than we put our trust in God. And here's where that becomes wrong for us. And if we want to use the word we can, where it becomes sin for us, is when we put more trust in the system than we put in God, and we depend on the system to bless us and to take care of us rather we spend on God. Because when you start spending those extra hours, and I'm not saying don't work overtime, I'm just saying, and we're gonna get there before I want to get there, but I'm just saying, Jesus is always looking at the heart of why we are doing things. Are we working that because we don't trust him to meet our needs? Or are we working that because we want to be a blessing to our company, to our fellow? All those things come into play in this arena and how our heart is. But it becomes a sin to us when we spend more time doing that. And then we say, I just don't have time to spend with God. I don't have time to pray. I don't have time to read my Bible. I don't have time to go to church. I don't have time to fellowship with other believers, which are all the things that grow us into our relationship with Christ. And so anything that moves us away from that and keeps us from doing that, or are we allowed to keep from doing, from us building that relationship, can become sin to us. Yes, sir. That is where worry comes in. It comes through the divided mind. That's why he says you can't serve me and money at the same time. One of them's going to get your attention. And too often, probably in our lives, throughout our lives, we have had those times where mammon became much more of our focus than God was. And it might have been out of our need, but then that shows our lack of trust in God. And so what Jesus is saying here, when you worry, you're indicating that you have some measure of a lack of trust in me. Because if you're trusting me, you should not worry. Because if I said I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. Robbie? Worry is what? Putting your faith in the devil. That's right. That's pretty strong, but that's good. That's true. When we have ourselves divided that way. Here Jesus is trying to simply tell us that he is going to supply every need and we need to trust him and to not worry. Yes. Yes, sir.
Worry and
faith failure. Okay, the Helms have some good one-liners about worry. I'm liking this. Worry is a faith failure and worry is putting your faith in the devil. We need to write those down, y'all. I like both of those. It's a faith failure. Now, thank God for his grace. Amen. And he knows how finite we are as human beings. Yes, sir. Yeah. That's a good illustration, too. What is our first response when trouble comes? How many of you ever had situations in your life? And they could be need situations like food or clothing, or they could be anything else. And then one day you went to God and said, Lord, I have tried everything. So now I want to give this to you. Last, where God becomes the last resort, what Jesus is saying here is he needs to be our first resort. Now, if we have that headache and he doesn't heal it right away, we pray and we ask him, he doesn't heal it right away, I got no problem with you going taking an aspirin. He allowed aspirin to be created, right? But our first response needs to be him, not our last response. Our first response doesn't mean need to be the devices of the world. Our first response needs to be putting our trust in him. So when you have one, yes, sir, I'll come right to you. When you have one of those months where you got more month than money, you got to put your trust in him. Now, he may direct you and show you some ways to create that, but you got to put your trust in him that he is going to supply your need because he said he would. Brother Mike? Say again. Worry, the question was, can worry be stronger than manna? Mammon, money. I'm sorry, I said manna. Mammon. Worry can cause us to focus on mammon. It'll change our focus. That's what worry will do. It will change our focus off of God and puts it on what we have need of instead of the one who can supply the need. Everybody tracking tonight? All right. Don't worry, you're going to have something to talk about in a minute, I promise you. Verse 31. It won't be quite like that, but verse 31 is coming. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things, the unregenerated, when you look into the Greek, Gentiles, he was speaking, really, the vast majority of who was listening to him were Jewish believers. These are things the Gentiles, the unregenerated, seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. So stop right there. We're not going to read 33 yet because 33 is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. But he's telling us a directive from God, don't worry. Worrying would be like you not ever having believed in me to begin with. You would be like those who have not come to know me yet when you worry. I mean, these are pretty strong words from Jesus when you break them down as to what he is trying to tell us. But then in verse 33, he says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. It's one of my favorite verses in Scripture. And here's what I want to say about that verse before we get your input, your thoughts, your experiences with this verse. The Bible is full of the truth. The Bible is the truth of God's Word, right? And a lot of the Bible, you have to contextualize it to understand the complete truth of the Word. Now, Christians, especially modern day Christians, us folks that are in here, we like cliche scriptures. I mean, let's just be real. We like to, there are scriptures that we love, and this is one of them. So all of God's Word is the truth of God's Word. But then within God's Word, there are truths of God's Word. All God's Word is truth. But in his word are truths that we can pick out, that you don't have to contextualize. They are either commands of God, directives of God, or promises of God. Now, some promises have to be contextualized because they're attached to an if. So you have to understand what the if is before you get the then. But this verse is a truth of God's word. It's one of the truths of his word. Seek first his kingdom and all these things shall be added unto you. So what is that saying? It's obvious, but what does it say? I said it was obvious. Don't sweat it. Don't worry. That's good. I like that. That sounds like a good message version of this scripture. There's a word in there that is the object for us. What is it? A little further down the sentence. The object of is the kingdom. See, everything we've talked about, food, clothing, all of that is necessary for us in this world. Right? What he is saying to us is seek first the kingdom of God. And can I tell you, he's not talking about heaven. We don't have to seek heaven. We know where heaven is, and we know that heaven is our destination. But remember the prayer he had us pray that Jesus taught us back in Matthew 5? Your kingdom come. Your will be done where? On earth as it is in heaven. So we are to seek the kingdom principles of God, the kingdom life that God has to live us. What does John 10:10 say? The thief comes but to kill, steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. What do we understand that to mean? What does life more abundantly mean to you? More things? It's about the kingdom. It's about experiencing his kingdom life, his kingdom blessings, his kingdom principles here. And they fly in the face of everything in the world that we learn. Everything. Forgiving those, turning your cheek, all that kind of stuff. That's kingdom stuff. And you know where we find kingdom stuff? In the Bible. In his word.
And so we're earthen vessels.
Right. That's exactly right. And I think that's what he's wanting us to pray when he says, pray this, pray my kingdom come and my will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We know that God's will for us in heaven is going to be accomplished. We have nothing to do with that. But his kingdom coming into our life is predicated on us receiving it, believing it, and walking in it. And that's why it takes faith, because the world has the things that we need to see. They're already there for us to see. To see God at work in our life, we can't see how he's going to meet our need until he's already met it. Right? I mean, most of the time when God shows up and meets a need in our life, if he brings healing in our life, if he brings provision, if he brings a supernatural blessing in our life, we didn't see how he was going to do that. But after we receive it, we know that it came from him. Couldn't have come from anywhere else. That's kingdom living here, trusting him with that. And here, well, let me ask you the question before I give you my opinion. Why do you think we struggle so much with kingdom, with pursuing the kingdom in that way, having that kind of faith to trust him? What's up? We can't see it. That's number one. There's an element that we struggle with too when we're asking God to meet our needs and trusting him. What is that?
The how.
The how. That's another way. But there's a word that starts with a T.
The here, the now, the urgent. It's just right there.
So you just described what I'm talking about, and that's time. The most difficult thing in walking a kingdom life is waiting on God to do what he said he's going to do. I think we don't have a problem trusting the knowledge that God will do it. I think our challenge comes in kingdom living with the timing of it. Because Tammy just described it. That's it. The longer it goes, the more we start thinking about other things or trying to do it ourselves. But you just talked about it. You described it as the urgent. What else was it? The here and the now and the urgent. And that's the struggle I believe that we have with kingdom living is the time element. We know what God's word says. And I think we have faith enough to believe that. I think what we struggle with the most is that Abraham timing that God tends to have in our life. Where he takes the child, goes up the mountain, builds the altar, ties him on it, raises the knife, and then God says, there's another sacrifice over here. I've provided for you as I said I would. Yes.
I almost said this while ago, but it's for right here. The time
time in our life where one of our children was really struggling. And Robbie alluded to it a little bit. We had faith, but the enemy came against us, and I hope I can say this right, but just flew in the face of that faith. And because we're in this world, there were times when I would get yanked back in this world. The Lord was accomplishing His word. He was adding these things to me. He was giving me. We were pursuing the Lord, you know, His will, and God was giving us peace in the midst of a trying time. But then there were times when the enemy would cause me to see the here and the now, and make me want to panic, if you will. And so for a moment, I would think, you know, I should be doing something. I should be doing more. And for that moment, it would be like God would let me see what that felt like to, for that to lift. And then I would experience the worry and the frantic thing. What about, well, we've got to do something. And I'm telling you, it did, you know, the times that, I would do, I didn't do it too many times, because by the end of that, I was ready to say, Lord, you know, this peace that passes bring it back to me.
We'll keep that.
And just walk in it.
Time is a difficult thing, because we want God to do what He said He's going to do, and we want Him to do it now. And God understands that in us, but that's why Jesus is saying, seek. And when you look that up, it's a active seeking. It's not seek once. It's continually seek My kingdom and My righteousness. Now this, you can't seek imputed righteousness. Imputed righteousness is when we get saved, Christ's righteousness is placed upon us. And so in God's eyes, we are made righteous. You can't pursue imputed righteousness. Right, that's righteousness that is given at the time of salvation. But He's saying, seek first My kingdom and My righteousness. So that is a pursuit of living a life that brings glory and honor to God. And what is the best way that we can honor God is by being obedient and trusting Him, which both take faith. You can't do either one of those without faith. I mean, you coming to church tonight is an act of your faith. In case you didn't know that, be reminded that you're exercising your faith a lot. When you pick up the scripture to read it, you're exercising your faith. And as you read it, you're growing your faith. When you come to church, when you do things in service of ministry, all of those things are an act of your faith, because you're doing them for a God that you cannot see in the physical realm. So this pursuit of His kingdom and desiring His kingdom to be evident, like you said, inside of us, in our life. And then one of the ways we do that is by pursuing a righteous life and a life that brings Him honor and glory, because that's what He honors. Has nothing to do with our salvation. Jesus is not talking about salvation here. He's talking about the life we live for Him after we're saved. Anybody? Comments? I thought I saw a hand almost go up. One of those close hands. So He says that about seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Now, we need to remember what all these things are. You know, He's going to meet our needs. He's going to clothe us. He's going to feed us. He's going to make sure we have that. And then these other things that He's been teaching us, those will be added to us as well, including the things that are going to follow. Yes, sir.
Direction, give me a specific date, and nothing to
took me to the airport that I had never met before in my life. I still didn't have the money. And it was before the days where you could go down in. And this guy went down in with me to see me on. And just as I was to go into the plane, he says, "Oh, I almost forgot. God spoke to me last night to give me this envelope." In the envelope was more than enough for the 6 months that I was going
to be. Wow. See, that's like one of those Abraham stories where you just keep acting on faith. I know God told me this. See, Abraham was acting on faith. He knew God had promised him that son. And he knew that he promised him that he was going to be the father of many. So his faith was intact all the way up to raising. I believe that Abraham believed that God was going to provide a way. But that's where we come back to that time issue, where time a lot of times would keep us from going on down to the airport and getting in line to get on the plane without what we know God said we needed when we needed to go. So by no means are we declaring tonight that this is an easy walk. By no means are we declaring tonight that if you start pursuing His kingdom that things are just going to drop right into place, because we live on this fallen world and we are going to face adversities. But what we do know is what God has said. And if it lines up, if what we believe God has said lines up with His word, then He is going to do it. You got to make sure what you believe God said lines up with the word, because if it doesn't, it wasn't God. He has no new information for us. It might be a new revelation to you. The truth of it might be a new revelation, but there's nothing new that He's giving us. He's going to confirm it in His word. But we need to pursue His kingdom. And then He'll tell us in verse 34, "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble." You know, Jesus wasn't preaching one of them shouting sermons to him, was he? Look what it says. Don't worry. Now, the shouting part is you ain't got to worry about tomorrow. Sufficient for today is the stuff you got going on, right? Think about Brother Fred and his van breaking down full of flowers. Sufficient for the day was the trouble. He didn't go out looking for the van to break down full of flowers, but it did. Think about John, the story he tells about driving that car across country when it shouldn't even been running. But we're going to face adversity, but through that adversity is how our faith grows. And when our faith grows, our trust grows. And when our trust goes, we're less likely to worry about the time element. Time is still tough to deal with, but the less likely we are to worry about the time element. But Matthew 6:33 is one of the great truths of Scripture. It's more than just a cool little memory verse that we learn in church. It is, if we do this, seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. And this righteousness is the pursuit of a life that is pleasing to God, because we already are righteous in God's eyes through what Christ did for us on the cross. So He's not talking about that righteousness. He's talking about the righteousness of living a life that is pleasing to Him. Pursue those things and He's going to take care of everything else. And look, we're all here today because God has been faithful. And we probably all have some stories. Now, we may still be going through some things that we're waiting for God to reveal His self in, but we're here tonight because God has been faithful to what He says He will do. Amen? Aren't you grateful for that? Yes, sir. I think that's why we as Christians experience life in the fallen world. And that's why He wants us to focus on pursuing His kingdom. Because if we focused on this world, we'd all stayed home tonight. We wouldn't have wanted to come out. If we focused on what's going on in this world and what's going on in our own little worlds that we have, we would not do it. But if we focus on His kingdom, it causes us to get up, get dressed, put the key in the ignition, come to church. It causes us to pick up that word and read it. It causes us to pause and pray and seek God's face over situations. Adversity, it's like the fire. It's like the gold that goes through the fire. There's stuff in our life that has to be burned off, and some of that is worry. So here's my last question for the, it's the chicken and the egg question for you. What do you think comes first, worry or doubt? What do you think? Let's poll the audience. How many of you say doubt comes first? Raise your hand. How many of you say worry comes first? Raise your hand. All right. I don't know that there's a right answer, but I'm going to give you my opinion. There you go. That's my opinion, is worry comes, and when worry comes, it causes you to start doubting. Because once you start worrying about something, doubt is right there. They're like joined together at the hip. Now, I'll take it the other way too, though, because if you start doubting God, worry will kick in. But normally, in my opinion, it's worry about, okay, God, are you going to answer this? Okay, God, it's been this long. I'm beginning to, you know, we don't say that with our mouth either, but we do it with our actions and in our minds. We begin to doubt. And so worry is the enemy of faith. Doubt is the outgrowth of worry that is the enemy of our faith. And so we need to not doubt and we need to not worry, either one. We need to trust God. I wish so bad tonight I could tell you it's such an easy thing to do. But I will tell you this, the more you do it, the easier it gets. The more you do it, the easier it gets. Yes, sir. We'll wrap up. I see some of the youth already. Yeah, that's good. Fear, doubt, and unbelief accompany worry. Fear, doubt, and unbelief accompany worry. So worry is the seed for those three things. Because when we start doubting, fear will come. Fear, will they ever get saved? Will God heal? Will God provide? And fear can kick in. Yes, ma'am. That's right. It's by the grace of God. So on that note right there, I will tie this in and maybe we'll get there next week. In Acts 1:8, remember we talked about this scripture setting the stage for Jesus sending us the Holy Spirit to help us work in this. In Acts 1:8, he says, you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses of me. Now, some translations say you shall be my witnesses, but some say you shall be witnesses of me. Those are two different things. They're similar, but they're different. Being a witness of me is that people watching your life will see Jesus. And how he does that is he empowers us by the Holy Spirit to go through this adversity, and then our life becomes a witness of Christ to other people. Now, we can also be his witnesses with our mouth, but our life makes us witnesses of him. And so when people see our life and our trust and our faith in God, it helps build theirs. And we got room full of folks that's building one another's faith up. You sure can. You sure can. I think, I can't remember which other famous old preacher said that. Preach the gospel and if necessary, use words. Who was it, David? Usually, St. Francis of Assisi. You know how I remember you knew? Because you told me last time. It was requoted by others, but St. Francis of Assisi is the one who started that. But here's the reality. I don't want to leave you hanging on that. Jesus does want us to speak the word to. He said it's through the foolishness of preaching that they will come to know Him. So we live our life pleasing to Him. We are a testimony and a witness of Him. And then by our mouth we witness for Him. Father, we thank You for Your word tonight. Thank You, Lord, that You are challenging us, that You are calling us, Lord, into a place where we seek Your kingdom. In all of this message that You've preached to us thus far through the first part of chapter 5, and I mean, of all of chapter 5 and into chapter 6, Lord, You're speaking the richness of Your direction for our life. Help us to embrace it. Help the Sermon on the Mount in our life never to be like it was before, that it'll be more powerful in our lives than ever. And we would read it, pursue it through the strength and power of Your Holy Spirit. Touch and heal those that need healing in their bodies tonight. Provide for those who need provision, Lord. Give wisdom and knowledge to those who are seeking answers, God. And increase our faith and trust in You as we go out and be witnesses for You and of You in a world that's lost, dying, and hurting with the only message of love, hope, and forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you for coming out tonight. We will see you on Sunday, right? Sunday.